Hello everyone, this is my second video about the person-centered approach, and in the first video I forgot to introduce myself. My name is Jonathan, or you can pronounce it the English way, which would be Jonathan, and I have a bachelor's degree in psychology, and I'm currently in the process of finishing my master's degree. I am not a psychotherapist in training or a practicing clinician. I only have some experience with psychotherapy through internships, among others. And I'm very interested in psychotherapy nevertheless, and I love teaching, and I read books about psychotherapy, and I want to talk about the stuff I read here on YouTube, because I think it's very interesting stuff. And if you are a psychotherapist in training, this stuff here might also be interesting to you, but also if you're just a person interested in psychotherapy in general. I try to stay as closely as possible to the original texts by Carl Rogers. That's why I'm including quotes. Anyway, let's get into it. Here again, I included a picture of Carl Rogers. And in this video and the next ones, I am going to talk about the core conditions of a therapeutic relationship. The three core conditions of a therapeutic relationship are the most important part in the theory of the person-centered approach, because the idea is that if these core conditions are present, then the therapy is likely to be successful. And the idea is that you don't heal by applying a certain method, but by approaching the situation with certain attitudes. Personally, I believe that just offering the right kind of relationship where the core conditions are present isn't enough to do successful therapy, but I think it's a very important basis for therapy. I think that without these core conditions, a therapy can fail very easily. And I will explain later why. And here are the three core conditions again. The first core condition is congruence. And this is also going to be the main topic of this video. I'm going to talk about congruence in this video. And it means basically that the therapist is genuine in the relationship. The second core condition is unconditional positive regard, which basically means that the therapist unconditionally accepts his client or unconditionally prizes his client. And the last core condition is empathic understanding. And those conditions are logically intertwined according to Carl Rogers. And he states that accurate understanding is actually the goal of the therapist. And for accurate understanding, the therapist needs to accept the client and prize him or her to some degree. Because without acceptance, the client won't really open himself or herself, and the therapist won't have an accurate picture of what is going on. The material that psychotherapy clients talk about can be very difficult for them to talk about and can be shameful, etc. And unconditional positive regard and the desire to understand, to empathically understand, need to be genuine. And here we come to the first core condition of congruence, and Carl Rogers states, "Therefore, it seems to me that genuineness or congruence is the most basic of the three conditions." So let's talk about congruence or genuineness or being real. What is congruence? I want to present an intuitive understanding because I think everyone knows what congruence is on some level. What does congruence mean? It means being transparent or honest or true to one's experience. It also has to do with meaning what you say and with body language being in line with verbal statements. So I think everyone knows what congruence is. Congruent persons are basically trustworthy, transparent, and yeah, real, genuine. So now we can ask, what is incongruence? It's the opposite of that. It's being fake. It's not being true to one's experience. For example, denying an emotion, even if it is clearly experienced. An example would be in a heated debate when someone says, "I am not emotional here, I'm just interested in the facts." And you can clearly see from the body language that this person is very emotionally involved. Then this would also be incongruence. Incongruence also has to do with trying to portray an image or putting on a facade. And it has to do with not really meaning what one says. And if you are incongruent, it's possible that your body language doesn't match verbal statements. So it's the opposite of congruence, and I don't want to claim that congruence is good and that incongruence is always bad. There are situations where you need to be incongruent, because you need to function in a certain way. But I think it's in general more healthy and more beneficial for personal relationships to be congruent. But I will talk about this in detail later. And now I want to show you a video that illustrates the last point. It's a commercial that I really like, and it has to do with body language not matching verbal statements.
I have not had enough to hear with you, young lady.
Why do you insist on treating me like an adult?
Because you insist on acting like one. Now you're getting this new phone.
But it's so small. I really like it. Why is it always what I want?
Well, do you have any idea how much money this is not going to cost me?
I love you.
I know you really mean that.
You never hated me, and you never will. You are the most grateful little...
Singular is changing the conversation about cell phones. Introducing the newest Go Phone.
So now we have a very vivid example of what it looks like when body language doesn't match verbal statements. And now I want to talk in detail about the concept of congruence. What does congruence mean? What does the word mean? The word means that something matches something else, or that something is in agreement with something else. And what is in agreement here? Basically three levels. And those levels are: experience is in agreement with awareness, and awareness is in agreement with communication. And here's an example of what this means. For example, a person might experience anger. So this is the experience. And the person is also aware that he or she is angry. So awareness is in line with experience. And the person also chooses to communicate this experience and says, I feel angry. In this example, all the three levels, experience, awareness, and communication, are in line with each other. And that is what Rogers means by congruence. And from this, you can derive two reasons why a person would be incongruent. The first reason is that there is a disconnect between experience and awareness. So the person isn't really aware of his or her experience. So in this example, the person is angry, and this doesn't reach awareness somehow. And the person thinks, I'm not angry, and therefore doesn't communicate his or her anger, and just says, no, I'm not angry, it's fine. This is an example where other people around the person might realize or read it in the body language that the person is angry but doesn't choose to communicate it. And this disconnect between experience and awareness can easily happen if the experience is threatening to the person, if the person feels that she must not be angry, or that it's forbidden to be angry, or that it would be detrimental to be angry. Then the person might process his or her anger in a defensive way, and therefore it might not really reach awareness. The second reason for incongruence is a disconnection between awareness and communication. And in this case, the person is aware of the anger, but doesn't communicate it. And says, no, I'm not angry, it's fine. And this, of course, happens very often. And sometimes there are very, very good reasons to be incongruent in this way. So those are the two reasons why people might be incongruent. And now I want to talk about what congruence means in a therapeutic setting. And to do this, I want to present a quote by Carl Rogers himself. You can pause the video and read the quote for yourself if you want, but I'm also going to read it aloud. So, Carl Rogers states that genuineness in therapy means that the therapist is his actual self during his encounter with his client. Without facade, he openly has the feelings and attitudes that are flowing in him at the moment. This involves self-awareness, that is, the therapist's feelings are available to him, to his awareness, and he is able to live them, to experience them in the relationship, and to communicate them if they persist. The therapist encounters the client directly, meeting him person to person. He is being himself, not denying himself. It means avoiding the temptation to present a facade or hide behind a mask of professionalism. This quote is taken from the introductory chapter of the book Carl Rogers' Dialogues. And in summary, there are two important aspects here. First, the idea of self-awareness. The therapist knows what he or she is experiencing, and the therapist also communicates his feelings if they persist. And this is important because there are several misunderstandings about congruence. Congruence does not mean communicating every feeling or disclosing the total self, but it means disclosing aspects that concern therapy or the therapeutic relationship. But also here, it's not necessary to communicate every little detail, but Carl Rogers said that it's important to communicate persistent feelings in the relationship. To summarize, I want to show you a video by Carl Rogers himself, where he himself explains the concept of congruence. And I'm sorry for the bad video quality. I hope you can still understand what he says. Anyway, here's the video.
From my own years of therapeutic experience, I've come to feel that if I can create the proper climate, the proper relationship, the proper conditions, a process of therapeutic movement will almost inevitably occur in my client. And then ask, what is this climate? What are these conditions? Will they exist in the interview with the woman I'm about to talk with, whom I've never seen before? Well, let me try to describe very briefly what these conditions are as I see them. First of all, one question is, can I be real in the relationship? This has come to have an increasing amount of importance to me over the years. I feel that genuineness is another way of describing the quality I would like to have. I like the term congruence, by which I mean that what I'm experiencing inside is present in my awareness and comes out through my communication. In a sense, when I have this quality, I'm all in one piece in the relationship. There's another word that describes it for me. I feel that in the relationship, I would like to have a transparency. I would be quite willing for my client to see all the way through me, that there would be nothing hidden. And when I'm real in this fashion that I'm trying to describe, then I know that my own feelings will often bubble up into awareness and be expressed, but be expressed in ways that won't impose themselves on my client. Then the second question I would have is, will I find myself praising this person, caring for this person? I certainly don't want to pretend a caring that I don't feel. In fact, if I dislike my client persistently, I feel it's better that I should express it.
Yeah, that was Carl Rogers, and I think there are two quotes in this video that are remarkable. The first one is, my own feelings will bubble up into awareness and be expressed in ways that won't impose themselves on my client. And the second quote is, in fact, if I dislike my client persistently, I feel it's better that I should express it. Yeah, and this is a very interesting point to me. It's a rather controversial aspect here. How do you communicate a dislike of your client, and should you communicate it? And according to Carl Rogers, yes, because it concerns the therapeutic relationship. But how do you go about this? And in this video series, I want to talk about the problems of this approach too. I want to talk in detail about the controversial aspects. And you can also comment something if you think that something is bullshit or if you think that something is weird. I liked the discussion, and I also want to talk about the more controversial points, otherwise this video series would be boring. So how do you go about communicating difficult feelings and attitudes in the mind of Carl Rogers? Well, here's a quote that describes this a bit. If I sense that I am feeling bored by a client, and if this feeling persists, I think I owe it to him and our relationship to share my feeling with him. The same will hold if my feeling were fear, or if my attention were so focused on my own problems that I could scarcely listen to him. But as I attempt to share such feelings with him, I want also to be constantly in touch with what is going on in me. If I am, I will recognize that I am expressing my own feelings of being bored and not some supposed fact about him as a boring person. When voiced as my own reaction, such an expression can lead to a deep relationship. But my feeling exists in the context of a complex and changing flow, which also needs to be communicated. I would like to share with him my distress at feeling bored and my discomfort in expressing it. As I do, I find that my boredom arises from my sense of remoteness from him, and that I would like to be in closer touch with him, and even as I try to express these feelings, they change. I am certainly not bored, as I wait with eagerness and perhaps a bit of apprehension for his response. I also feel a new sensitivity to him now that I have shared this feeling, which has been a barrier between us. I am far more able to hear the surprise, or perhaps the hurt, in his voice, as he now finds himself speaking more genuinely, because I have dared to be real with him. I have let myself be a person, real, imperfect, in my relationship with him. So, in this series of quotes, there are several important aspects. The first one is that the therapist communicates his own feelings and not facts about the other person, and he needs to make that clear, or in the manner of communication, this needs to be clear. And the second aspect is that the therapist should communicate the full complexity of feelings and not just the one aspect of being bored. So also the distress at feeling bored, or how difficult it is to share it, his discomfort. Also, feelings will constantly change, and this should also be communicated. Personally, I don't know if I would communicate such difficult feelings just like this. I would talk to my supervisor first, I guess. Anyway, you might have wondered, why should you be congruent? Why is this concept so important? Why should you communicate so much about yourself? Why should you communicate your feelings about the relationship and about the client? Here are some reasons to consider. Congruence has to do with building trust. Being transparent and open with the client is good for the trust that needs to be there in the relationship, because a client might sense a false posture of interest, concern, and liking. It also has to do with signal congruence. If you try to be congruent, if you communicate your feelings in an honest way, then your body language is more likely to be in accordance with your verbal statements. So this also has to do with trust and transparency. If your body language says something else than your verbal statements, then this might be irritating or upsetting for the client. For example, if you are bored by a client and the client asks you about it and you deny being bored, but yawn all the time and look at your watch, then this might irritate a client, of course, or he might sense that there's something going on, that you're not being honest in the situation. The second reason is that congruence serves as a model, and it makes sharing easier for the client if the therapist shows what it is like to share, how you share difficult stuff. Because sharing is always a risk in therapy, especially if it's about very personal issues that are maybe shameful, etc., or difficult to talk about. And if the therapist takes the initiative and is the first person to share, then this might make sharing easier for the client. And the last reason is that it can revive a therapy process that is at a standstill. This was already hinted at before when Rogers talked about being bored by a client. If you communicate it, and if you communicate your distress at being bored, and that you want to be in closer touch with the client, this might revive a boring therapy process. So all in all, it seems to me that there are quite good reasons why you should think about being congruent and being real as a person in the relationship. And I want to show you two examples of Carl Rogers being congruent with an apparently positive effect. Of course, I have a sampling bias here. I don't know all the examples where therapists are congruent and where this completely goes wrong. This would also be interesting to analyze what exactly goes wrong there. But here are examples where it went right, where it had a positive effect on the process of therapy. The first example is taken from the book The Psychotherapy of Carl Rogers, Cases and Commentary. And here we have a client called Jim Brown. Jim Brown is a 20-year-old male who was diagnosed with schizophrenia, and the setting is a hospital. And there's one remarkable aspect about the therapy with Jim. There are often long and extended periods of silence in the therapy sessions with Jim. They sometimes last up to 18 minutes, So imagine that, Carl Rogers and Jim Brown sitting in silence for 18 minutes. I don't know if you practicing therapists out there have similar experience where you sit in silence with your client for such a long period of time, but it seems to me a kind of difficult or uncomfortable situation, I don't know. I assume that it's something that you need to learn as a therapist, to be comfortable with silence. And in this example here, I want to present you the therapy dialogue, word by word. And here Jim expresses his desire to take off. He does not know where he wants to go and says that he doesn't care. And Carl Rogers viewed the following dialogue as a turning point in his therapy with Jim. And here it comes. So Jim Brown says, I might go today. Where? I don't know, but I don't care. Carl Rogers answers, you just feel that your mind is made up and that you're going to leave. You're not going to anywhere. You're just going to leave. Hmm? So he basically paraphrases what Jim Brown has said. That's why I want to go, because I don't care what happens. And Carl Rogers says, huh? That's why I want to go. I don't care what happens. Hmm. That's why you want to go. You really don't care about yourself. You just don't care what happens. And I guess I'd just like to say, I care about you and I care what happens. And then there's a period of silence for 30 seconds. And then Jim bursts into tears and unintelligible sobs. And he cries for quite some time. And this is a turning point in his therapy, apparently. And I think that this is a good example of a situation where you need to be genuine and where you need to be present as a human being and where an expression of honest caring can really make a difference. So in times of crisis, I think it might be very important to be genuine and to be present as a human being and not as a professional. Jim and Carl Rogers worked together for 166 sessions over a period of 2.5 years. And after release from hospital, Jim writes a letter to Carl Rogers. All in all, things couldn't be too much better for me compared to what they have been. It sure feels good to be able to say to hell with it when things bother me. So there's basically a positive outcome here. And before talking about the second example, which is a bit more unusual and a bit crazier, I would say, I want to talk about some things that Carl Rogers says about trusting your therapeutic instincts, your moment-to-moment feelings in therapy. And he says, sometimes a feeling rises up in me, which seems to have no particular relationship to what is going on. Yet I have learned to accept and trust this feeling in my awareness and try to communicate it to my client. And this is an interesting attitude. Imagine that. There's some kind of instinct you have and you communicate it, even if it seems to have no relationship to what is going on. And he talks about an example. For example, a client is talking to me and I suddenly feel an image of him as a pleading little boy, folding his hands in supplication, saying, please let me have this, please let me have this. I have learned that if I can be real in the relationship with him and express this feeling that has occurred in me, it is very likely to strike some deep note in him and to advance our relationship. And the next example shows a situation like this, where Carl Rogers has an impulse that he doesn't understand himself, but he chooses to trust his impulse, and it has a positive effect, apparently. And this is an example with a girl called Anne, and it's not a therapy session, but an encounter during a workshop. Carl Rogers also gave workshops. And the context is that Carl Rogers was invited by a high school to work in a program of self-directed educational change. Yeah, as I said, this is not a therapy session, but a workshop. And Anne is a high school student in this workshop. She is a good student, an effective leader, and a quiet person. And she's going through difficult times. She's questioning her religious faith and her values. And there's an element of despair in her experience. And the situation is one morning where very moving feelings are expressed among the students and where the group pauses into silence for some time. And Anne breaks into the silence with highly intellectual questions, and Carota says, "Those were perfectly reasonable questions, but somehow not at all appropriate to what was going on." I felt at some intuitive level that she was not saying what she wanted to say, but she gave no clue as to what her real message might be. I found myself wanting to go over and sit next to her, but it seemed a crazy impulse, since she was not in any obvious way asking for help. The impulse was so strong, however, that I took the risk, crossed the room, and asked if I could sit by her on the couch, feeling that there was a large chance that I would be rebuffed. She made room for me, and as soon as I sat down, she leaped into my lap, threw her hands over my shoulder, and burst into sobs. And here's the dialogue that ensues. Carota says, "How long have you been crying?" And says, "I haven't been crying." "No, I mean, how long have you been crying inside?" And she says, "For 8 months." And Carota says that he simply held her until the sobbing gradually subsided. So this is an example where Carota trusts his impulse, which seemed like a crazy impulse at first, but somehow this was the right thing to do. And I find this very interesting, a bit spooky maybe, I don't know. Yeah, I don't know what to think about this, how often such impulses occur in therapy. If you are a therapist in training, you can definitely write in the comments whether you had a crazy impulse that advanced therapy. Anyway, I also want to give you the outcome of the situation, and then proceeds to describe that she feels that she can be of help to others, but that no one could love her. Her parents had separated, she greatly missed her father, and she later wrote letters to Carl Rogers telling him how much the incident meant to her. So this situation helped her to talk about what really bothered her. Yeah, and I think this is very interesting and something to think about, in how far you can and should trust your impulses as a therapist. So this has been basically what I wanted to say about congruence. And if you read Carl Rogers very closely, well, not too closely, because it's actually pretty obvious, then it becomes clear that for Carl Rogers, congruence is not just something that is important for therapy, but that congruence is basically a way of life for him. And this becomes obvious in this following quotes that I want to present to you. Here's a quote where he says, "In my relationship with persons, I have found that it does not help in the long run to act as though I were something that I am not. It does not help to act calm and pleasant when actually I'm angry and critical. It does not help to act as though I know the answers when I do not." And the quote continues with, "In fact, it seems to me that most of the mistakes I make in personal relationships, most of the times in which I fail to be of help to other individuals, can be accounted for in terms of the fact that I have, for some defensive reason, behaved in one way at a surface level, while in reality my feelings run in a contrary direction." And another quote, "I find it very satisfying when I can be real, when I can be close to whatever it is that is going on within me. I like it when I can listen to myself. I am disappointed when I realize, and of course this realization always comes afterward, after lack of time, that I've been too frightened or too threatened to let myself get close to what I am experiencing, and that consequently I have not been genuine or congruent." So I think from this series of quotes, it's pretty obvious that congruence is a way of life for Carl Rogers. And when I read first about congruence, I really liked this concept, and I was obsessed with this concept for some time. And I want to talk about my personal experience with this concept, with the attempt at being congruent. As I said in my first video, the person-centered approach is all about personal experience, and this is why it makes sense, and this is why it's completely in the spirit of this approach to talk about my personal experience. Here are some pros and cons about the attempt at being congruent, or about this idea of being congruent. I felt that conversations that I had were more lively or more interesting, because I talked about what I really was feeling, and somehow this brought a great flow into the conversation and made it very interesting. And I find that I get more out of social situations like this. And I also realize that when I'm trying to be congruent and when I'm close to my experience or what I'm feeling inside, I feel more alive. And I also feel less doubtful about myself or what I want. Yeah, and this is positive. There are also some negative aspects, because if you have negative feelings that you have had for a long period of time, then those feelings might come out in a not so constructive way. This also happened to me, so shame on me. And I also think that the idea of being congruent, if you try to be congruent, that this might amplify dysfunctional thinking or maladaptive emotions. All in all, I would recommend trying to be congruent, especially in personal relationships. I don't know if I would recommend it for every professional situation. About the negative points. Personally, I like to be close to my experience. And even if there's negative stuff, I want to know about it. I want to be aware of it. And even if there are dysfunctional tendencies, I want to know them so I can deal with them. So all in all, even if those aspects, if those negative aspects on the contra side are true, in my opinion, or from my experience, it's still a good thing overall, and it's good to be aware of the bad stuff going on inside of you, so you can properly deal with it. Oh, and by the way, I don't mean to suggest that I'm always congruent. No one is. No one is always congruent. It's very difficult to be always congruent. Everyone is incongruent at some points, and yeah, it's more an ideal to strive towards. And one thing that I also have to say about congruence is, when you try to be congruent, you often get into situations that are kind of uncomfortable for you, but I think more satisfying in the long run. Because there are often situations, at least for me, there were often situations where I wanted to say something, where I felt very uncomfortable about saying this, and where I wasn't sure how this would be received by the other person. But those are really interesting and exciting moments in a way. And yeah. So yeah, I love this concept. I learned a great deal about myself in the process, and I would definitely recommend it. And by this, I've reached the end of my video. And in the next video, I'm going to talk about unconditional positive regard. So about the second core condition, which is also really, really important for therapy. Thanks for tuning in. Here are my references. You can leave comments or criticism or anything you want to talk about in the comment section. I would be glad to read anything you might have to say, and I will try to answer it. So yeah, thank you, have a nice day, and until next time.